Think about your favorite artist or song. Now try to assign it to a particular genre. Can you do it? Hi everyone, welcome to Music Theories, where we explain and analyze all topics related to music. Be sure to subscribe for more content, especially if you are a music geek like me. I've recently had an interesting conversation regarding whether or not genres are still relevant. Today I'm going to dive into this topic to the best of my abilities. First, let's ask, what is a genre, and how are music genres classified? So according to Google, a genre is a category of artistic composition characterized by similarities in form, style, or subject matter. In music, we categorize based on the techniques and instrumentation being used in a particular piece. A blues song will almost always have a 12-bar form and commonly uses the 1, 4, and 5 chords in a specific pattern. Hip-hop relies heavily on a rhythmic beat, employs some style of rapping, and often uses samples of other songs. One might even say that music can be categorized based on the audience or the lyrical content as well. Some folk music and country music is similar in terms of origin, instrumentation, and techniques, but many separate the two based on themes and lyrical style. Folk revival music of the 1960s was often written in protest, while country music of the same era was largely ballads of storytelling and quips of Southern pride. So now that we know the what about the why? What purpose do genres serve? Is it simply our innate human desire to categorize things? Or is there a greater purpose to genre classification, such as marketing? Today, we categorize music preceding the 1900s by period. For example, we have the Baroque period from 1600 to 1750, the Classical period from 1750 to 1830, and the Romantic period from 1830 to 1900. Now, there were technically genres of music at this point, such as opera, concerto, chanson, etc. But today, anyway, the music of these eras is often grouped in a more general sense. For now, I'll be focusing on the music of the 20th century. In 1899, Scott Joplin released Maple Leaf Rag, which helped set the popularity of what was known as ragtime in motion. This craze, which lasted until the 1910s, changed the course of American music throughout the 20th century. Many businessmen realized that music was more than art. It was a product. As the American music business grew, the idea of genre really solidified. For example, we had an explosive jazz movement from the 1920s all the way through the 1940s, until rock and roll completely dominated in the 1950s. Of course, there were other genres of music that maintained popularity, such as country throughout the 20th century. But in looking at the data, we were able to see quick upticks in particular genres based on what was trending. Even then, I personally have to question the validity of these genres. Jazz becomes very vague when you consider that you had Dixieland jazz, big band jazz, bebop, and so on. Similarly, R&B of the 40s and 50s was any music played by black musicians. This included blues, ragtime, and jazz. Blues itself can be broken up into many, many subgenres, but I digress. There's a great visual timeline of music trends from 1910 to 2018 done by Data is Beautiful that I'll link in the description. Now, the music industry is largely responsible for this. They were determined to find the best-selling product and push sales at any given time. That said, I do think there are a few other factors to consider when looking at trends of music. What is the intent of the music, and what are the means of consumption? Prior to innovations in listening technologies, the most feasible way to hear the music you wanted to hear was to go out and hear it played live, or learn to play it yourself. Next came the phonograph, and then the flat disc, which allowed people to listen at home. Eventually, radio stations began to broadcast music, which not only dictated what the listener was hearing, but gave them access to free music. At this point, genres are important, not only for the marketer, but for the listener. If you were a person who liked opera, you could walk into a record store and find exactly what you're looking for. If you liked rock, you could turn to the radio station known to broadcast the hottest rock songs. Similarly, when it came to writing music, you could write based on the target audience of a particular genre. Labels knew that teenagers would buy rock records in the 1950s, so they wrote rock songs with lyrical content that would resonate with teenagers. A great example of this is New York's Brill Building, but that's a topic for another video. Based on this, we can see how genres can be used as a device to sell a product. As music and technology continued to evolve, the lines between genres became more obscure. The use of the computer in music allowed for new kinds of sounds and styles that didn't necessarily fit the mold of any particular genre. You also had well-known artists crossing over into other realms of style. Michael Jackson is a good example of this, as he toggled between soul funk fusion rock, and new jack swing. And thus, the songs reaching the top 40 charts each week were becoming more diverse. Adding the revolutionary internet and music streaming into the mix changed music in a huge way. Listeners were no longer limited to the music they heard on the radio, expanding people's music taste to be even more diverse. One could argue that this access to new and different music, as well as the access to home recording software, eventually influenced new artists to blend styles and cross lines even more. This could have decreased the practicality of genre as a means of targeting a particular audience. So, what is the most popular type of music today? Many will answer pop. But from my perspective, pop is not a genre, but rather any type of music that is popular at a given time. Obviously, this has changed with each decade. Let's quickly look at the top-selling albums of 2019. Lover by Taylor Swift is defined as synth pop / electro pop. When We All Fall Asleep, Where Do We Go? By Billie Eilish is also defined as electropop. Thank You Next by Ariana Grande is defined as R&B / trap. Beer Bongs and Bentleys by Post Malone is defined as hip-hop / R&B. Do these seem accurate to you? When you Google synth pop, Taylor Swift doesn't come up at all. Instead, Google recommends overviews and playlists pointing to the front runners of synth pop, like Depeche Mode, The Human League, and Gary Numan. Do you see any similarities between these artists? Enough to qualify them within the same genre? Granted, these songs are from roughly 30 years ago, so let's narrow it down. If you Google synth pop 2019, again, Taylor Swift doesn't come up. One of the top results is Sharon Van Etten, who in my opinion doesn't sound much like Lover at all. To be fair, aside from Comeback Kid, there aren't a ton of similarities between Van Etten and the pioneers of synth pop either. Now, I'm not saying that these artists should sound anything like each other. I love the idea that artists can have their own unique and definitive sound. The question I have is whether or not it's necessary to lump these artists into not-so-specific categories. Are these categories based on the music itself? Or is it still a device to find and influence a particular audience? But even so, we see the genre umbrella get so wide that it becomes inaccurate about particular groups of people. You could ask a hard bop lover how they feel about smooth jazz, or a prog rock aficionado what they feel about glam metal, and you'd probably get some colorful responses. Maybe genre classification is simply a means of communicating ideas with other musicians and listeners. This does allow us to create and recommend music more accurately, but can also be seen as a box that is unnecessary. Maybe it is just that innate human desire to organize things in one way or another. The blending of genres over the years has created an extremely long list of subgenres that total up to over 1,000. It's not a coincidence that a chart of musical genres looks a lot like a taxonomy chart. It is certainly easier to navigate through an overwhelming amount of music using this system. But is there an alternative system? David M. Greenberg, a music psychologist from the University of Cambridge, teamed up with more music psychologists to brainstorm a new system where music is characterized by mood, personality, or response, rather than instrumentation and style. We can already see this being effectively used on streaming sites like Spotify, who create playlists based on moods and activities such as Sunny Day, Reading Soundtrack, and Mood Boosters. Or even on YouTube, where we have two-hour lo-fi hip-hop for studying. What do you guys think? When someone asks you to describe the music you like, how do you do it? Do you think genres are outdated? Let me know your thoughts in the comments and subscribe for more music history and analysis content. Thanks for watching.